start. Thanks everyone for coming. I see a lot of familiar faces and a few that I don't know. My name is Sotiris Mamalis. I'm this guy over here. I'm an assistant professor in mechanical engineering. I'm here to introduce to you Emilios, who has been my student for the last couple of years. Emilios came from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, that is in Greece, and that's where he did his undergrad. And he was recruited here in a combined master's and PhD program in mechanical engineering to work on computational fluid dynamics for internal combustion engines. So I know that we have a collection of different disciplines in the room, but hopefully after this short presentation, you will have a better idea of what we're doing. I don't want to take up too much time. I just want to mention that I'm happy that we're starting to have this student seminar series. I think it's going to be beneficial for everyone. I believe this presentation is about 15 to 20 minutes long, so if you have any questions, feel free to interrupt the videos, or you may make an order and then ask at the end. I'm sure he'll be happy to answer. Okay, thanks a lot, everyone, and enjoy the presentation.
Thank you, Sotiri. So let's start. My name is Emilios Ofianopoulos. As my advisor mentioned, I'm a PhD candidate at the Department of Mechanical Engineering at the moment. And I'm going to give you a presentation about computational fluid dynamics for computational fluid dynamics simulations of internal combustion engine using natural gas. So let's start a little bit with what is it in, with an outline of my presentation. I'm going to talk to you a little bit briefly about the operation of an internal combustion engine. We're going to talk a little bit about lean natural gas engines, and we're also going to talk a little bit about the drivers of research in our field of expertise, which is the emissions regulations and also the philosophy of engine design. Then we're going to talk briefly about what is computational fluid dynamics and why it's useful in engine design. I'm going to give you a brief overview of the theoretical background and the equations we use to model internal combustion engines. And then we're going to talk about mass generation, and we're going to follow it with steps to complete a computational fluid dynamics simulation. To wrap it up, I'm going to show you the results of a model we created for the simulation of lean natural gas engines. We're going to focus mostly in flame propagation and NOx formations. So let's start with what is an internal combustion engine. An internal combustion engine is a machine that that converts chemical energy into work. And we can classify internal combustion engines into spark ignition engines, where a spark is used to ignite the working fluid. And these are the common gasoline engines we have in our cars. And in compression ignition engines, where the mixture is compressed until it auto-ignites, and these are mostly the diesel engines that we have in bigger vehicles like trucks. They can both be four-stroke or two-stroke, which means that a four-stroke engine has one combustion event per two cycles, and a two-stroke has one combustion event per one cycle. And this presentation is going to focus on four-stroke internal combustion engines, which are spark-ignited and use natural gas as a fuel. So let's show a small animation over here of what's going on in the internal combustion engine. First, we start with the intake, and the intake mixture is then compressed until it reaches a high pressure and temperature, and then the spark ignites it, and we have combustion. As the piston goes down again, the hot gases expand and they produce work, and then as the piston ascends, we have this exhaust gas is driven out of the combustion chamber into the exhaust, and from there to the environment. So let's show something a little bit more practical over here. This is a V8 engine, and this engine consists of two lines of four-cylinder seats which shape a V. And as you can see, the pistons don't move synchronously, so we have combustion events at different times in different cylinders. So you can see over here the crankshaft of the internal combustion engine as it operates, and you can also see the spark plug, which is the piece of machinery that provides the energy that's necessary to ignite the mixture spark ignition engine. So let's talk a little bit about lean natural gas engines. First of all, I'm going to have to justify why we use natural gas. Natural gas has a lower cost per BTU compared to other conventional fuels, and especially petroleum-based fuels. It also has very high octane number, close to 140. It also has the potential to have lower CO2 emissions because it has higher hydrogen to carbon ratio. And also the reserves of natural gas are higher and they are always increasing compared to the reserves for petroleum and gas, for petroleum actually. So let's talk a little bit about what is a lean combustion. Lean combustion is a combustion where the mixture has less fuel than it should stoichiometrically have. So over here, I specify lambda, which is going to be used as an index to specify how lean our combustion is, and it's the ratio of air fuel to air fuel, of the air fuel ratio to the stoichiometric air fuel ratio. So why do we like lean internal combustion engines? First of all, we like them because they have much lower NOx emissions, and NOx emissions are one of the major limitations in engine design, and also they have the potential for higher thermal efficiency. The problem we have with them is that, first of all, when we go very lean, we cannot ignite the mixture very easily. And the second problem is the controllability of combustion, which sometimes makes the combustion unstable and unacceptable for driving your vehicle around. So, got a little crazy, right? I'm sorry. Yep. Okay. So over here, you can see that as the mixture becomes leaner, so as lambda increases in this case, we have higher efficiency, and we also, the COV, which is the index of instability in the internal combustion engine operation, increases. So there is a trade-off between efficiency and stability, and also you can see that as we go leaner, NOx emissions diminish, and they go to near zero as we go very lean. So let's start a little bit to talk briefly about what's the drivers of research. We have very increasingly stringent emissions regulations, and we also have the depletion of fossil fuels. These are the two major limitations. So in our engine design, we have mainly four goals. The first is to improve efficiency. The second one is to reduce emissions, especially of NOx, soot, and carbon dioxide. And we also, of course, want to reduce cost and increase the durability of the engine. So in order to talk how CFD is able to help us with that, let's first see a little bit briefly what is CFD. So CFD stands for computational fluid dynamics. And in a CFD model, we're trying to solve the three-dimensional equations for the conservation of mass, energy, and momentum from fluid dynamics, couple them with chemical calculations for combustion, and also calculate heat transfer and heat release. This sounds easy, but it's not, because we have a constantly moving geometry, and on top of that, we have to couple the chemistry, the fluid dynamics, and the heat release. And this can be very difficult and very troublesome, and also we have very high computational costs. So CFD is very helpful in the process of designing an engine, because it allows us to test many different design options without having to create a prototype, so we have cost reduction and time benefits, and it also gives us insight in what happens inside the cylinder, which cannot be done experimentally. But in the end, in order to have a full design process, we're going to have to couple the CFD results with experimental results in an actual engine. Okay, so let's give a little bit of a brief description of what equations we use. We use the three-dimensional Navier-Stokes conservation equation for momentum, energy, and mass. We couple this equation with the ideal gas law in order to calculate the fluid dynamics motion. And you can see on the left-hand side on the top a calculation based on that for the intake flow in an internal combustion engine. Also, we couple these equations with equations for species conservation. And in order for the chemically reactive flow to be calculated, we have to introduce a chemical kinetics mechanism. This mechanism breaks down the reactions that are necessary for the combustion of the fuel into a simple set of elementary reactions and elementary species, and it calculates the chemical kinetics based on that. In our case, we use GRI-MEC, and we are lucky into that because this mechanism has been developed for over 20 years, and there is a lot of experimental results, and it's pretty robust for simulations of natural gas combustion. Yep. So let me show you a little bit how a model works. That's actually our model. And let's talk about the flow into the engine. So the mixture comes through the intake to the intake manifold, goes through the intake port, and then it goes to the valve area. Here in the valves, there is the valves and the valve seats. We seal the valves in order to have control of the flow into the combustion chamber. And the combustion chamber consists of the piston over here, the liner, which is the cylinder of the engine, the head, and the spark plug, which provides the energy for the ignition of the mixture. Then, when the combustion is complete, and after the expansion, the mixture goes through the exhaust valve over here, which again seals with the exhaust valve seat, goes through the exhaust port to the exhaust manifold, and then it goes outside of the combustion chamber, outside of the engine to the environment. So our model has a set of sub-models embedded in it, and these sub-models are used to simulate the motion of moving parts, such as the piston and the valves. We can also do combustion modeling, as I mentioned before, with the chemical kinetics mechanism. We have different models for solving the three-dimensional Navier-Stokes equations and accounting for turbulence. And also we have sub-models to calculate species concentrations, passive concentrations, track properties of interest, such as radiation or sprays in diesel engines. And practically there are many capabilities that are not mentioned over here as well. So let me talk to you a little bit about the steps to complete a run in internal combustion engine simulation. First of all, I have to clarify that we're using a commercial software. It's called Converge. It consists of two parts. The first one is a graphical user interface into which we can import a geometry and import data about our models and submodels, and from which we get a set of input files, and these input files go to the solver of Converge, which is its second part, and it's installed in handy LiRed. The code is executed, and through the execution of the code, we get a couple of types of outputs. The first one is vector outputs, and in order to be able to visualize vector outputs, we use another software, which is a very powerful visualization software for computational fluid dynamics. It's called DenSight. And this is responsible for some of the videos you're going to see in the following slides. And also we have MATLAB to convert to get output mostly for our understanding and to post-process scalar outputs. So let's talk a little bit about something that's probably more interesting to people over here, which is the mass generation in internal combustion engine simulation. We have actually three ways of controlling the grid. The first one is through specifying an initial grid size from the user, and this can stay as it is for the whole simulation. This is the base grid we see over here. But in order to have mass refinement in some places, some regions of interest, the user has a couple of options. The first one is to use fixed embedding, and what it is a way of refining the grid at a specific part of the simulation, of the computational domain, for a specific amount of time. And you can see over here, in this animation that's going to play in a while, that we had fixed embedding into the combustion chamber, and much more refined fixed embedding, very close to the spark plug in order to capture the initiation of combustion. And also, we have something called AMR. This stands for adaptive mass refinement. And what AMR does is that, based on the gradient of specific properties into the computational domain, it allows for refinement or coarsening of the grid so that the combustion process or the flow field can be captured. The properties of interest in an internal combustion engine simulation are mostly velocity, temperature, species concentrations, and maybe pressure. So let me show you an animation. Go ahead. Not exactly. The fixed embedding, it doesn't have to do with the uniformity of the grid or not. You can specify different levels of embedding at different parts. For example, if you see over here, the whole the computational domain is embedded with a level of embedment of 2 or 3 in this case, actually. And over here in the spark plug, this sphere, we specify a sphere of much more refined grid, where the embedding level is 5.
And you do this a priori?
Yeah. This is because sometimes when you have a very coarse grid, the adaptive mesh refinement cannot be activated very well because you cannot capture the gradient. So this actually aids in capturing the gradients so that adaptive mesh refinement can take over and complete the grid manipulation.
Okay.
Yep, it is, but the thing is that the mesh in every time step changes because there is moving geometries. So we're trying to have a mesh that's, we're trying to have a squares all around, but when we go very close, I suppose that you mean over here, for example, in the boundaries. Okay, over there, we just have very, very thin squares over here, and we're trying to make it as close as possible to the realistic geometry. Over here, it might not be visible in this video, but the last layer is very, very small.
So on the curved portions, it's actually, if you actually went down to the resolution, the element size would be jagged?
Yeah, okay. But it's that thing that you have to go really down in the resolution. Okay. So let me go on. So we have the fixed embedding over there, and you see that the flame propagates, and as the flame propagates, on the borderline of the flame, we have high gradients of temperature and species concentration. So over here, we have adaptive mesh refinement, and the mesh is very refined in order to capture these gradients. So let's look for something that I know that Scott is going to be very interested in. This is parallel efficiency. So the algorithm we are using right now, according to measurements that have been done from Argonne National Labs in collaboration with the company that created the algorithm, is 70%, shows a 70% theoretical efficiency in 1,024 cores. So let me talk to you briefly about the capabilities of our model. Our model is able to track a flame in an internal combustion engine. And in spark ignition engines, tracking the flame is very significant because this is the way we can estimate the pollutant formation. We can estimate the time of ignition. We can estimate if it ignites, which I showed you that it might be a problem in internal combustion engines. And also we can control efficiency. By adjusting the flame and the duration of the flame, we can control efficiency in spark ignition engines. So in the following videos, we're going to see on the bottom here OH radicals. And the reason I'm using them is because they are short-lived radicals, which are formed on the flame front, and they are the trackers of flame in an internal combustion engine simulation. And also we can see methane, which is our fuel, because natural gas is practically 90% methane. And CO2 mass fraction, which is the product of complete combustion. So we would expect that methane reduces as combustion starts, radicals are formed and then deformed, and then consumed, I'm sorry, and we have formation of CO2. So let's start. So now that the piston compresses the working fluid, which is a mixture of natural gas and air, and at this point, we have the flame kernel formation, which is actually the initiation of combustion. And as the flame starts propagating, we have the flame propagation over here, and we can track the flame front by the OH radicals, and we can see that it coincides with the consumption of methane. And we can also see something that's going to be even more visible in the continuation of this video, that we have CO2 formation, but it's not complete, because CO2 is a final product of combustion, and there are some intermediate reactions that take place, and CO2 is actually formed in the end. So as the flame goes down, as the piston goes down, the flame expands, it consumes practically all of the methane, as you can see on the top video, and we have a slight increase of CO2 mass fraction, and we can see that as the piston goes down even more, OH radicals start disappearing, and we have increased formation of CO2, which leads to our complete combustion. That's it. And so over here, we're going to talk a little bit about the Knox formation and the ability of the model to predict Knox formation. On the left, we see a video of temperature as a function of crank angle degrees, which is the time scale in internal combustion engine applications. And on the right, we see Knox formation. And what we can see over here is that it's going to be even more visible in a snapshot I have right now, is that we have a very good agreement with theory in the fact that Knox formation is a thermal phenomenon. So Knox starts increasing as temperature increases, and it starts increasing exponentially after 1700 Kelvin. So as we have high temperatures over here in the combustion chamber, we have a delay because of it takes some time to form Knox, but we can see that the places where the higher temperatures appear are where Knox formation, are where we had Knox formation. And if we go back into our animation, we see that in the end, this Knox that had been formed, it has also decomposed because as the temperature goes down and the piston descends. And another, this is a little bit tricky. Anyways, another capability of our model is its ability to predict the Knox formation trend that's relevant to lean combustion. So if you see the plot over here, as the lambda goes up, we have a slight increase in Knox formation initially, as it was predicted by experimental results, and then the model can predict that the Knox formation starts dropping until it's close to zero, when we go to very, very lean mixtures. So this is our current work, and our future work, which is going to be a continuation of the project we're currently doing, is to have additional simulations for the incorporation of a mixture of hydrogen and CO called syngas in lean natural gas engines, and also to expand our model to diesel engines and start using syngas to simulate its effect on diesel engines. So at this point, I would like to thank you, and please feel free to ask me any questions. I'm not sure I understand your question.
Which method this software converts handle the moving boundary?
I know that the mesh is regenerated in every time step. I don't know exactly which method. They're trying to keep it as orthogonal as possible because it's easier for the algorithm they use. But I don't know if they use a method or they just regenerate it based on the geometry on every time step.
Does the software allow you to use other methods does the software let you, instead of regenerating the mesh every time, move the mesh using, say, something like an ale type method, or?
No, the mesh is regenerated in every time step. Excuse me?
What is NOx?
NOx is nitrogen oxides. They are one of the major limitations in engine design, as I mentioned earlier before, because they are very strictly regulated. It's actually NO and NO2. They are both of those elements, of those species.
How many cells you have?
The number of cell changes with every time step, because of the techniques I showed you. A rough estimation is close to 2 to 3 million when we start the simulation, because we have the whole computational domain, and it can get much more computationally expensive with high levels of embedding in AMR.
How many cores
do
you use?
32 or 64, depends on the case and how quickly we want it done, and the availability, of course.
What is the runtime?
Again, it depends on the run. If we want to run the whole engine simulation in 32 cores, it takes close to 7 days. It's the whole cycle. It's the four. Yeah.
Would you like to explain what a cycle is?
Yeah. So I think we're going to have to go a little bit back to explain the whole cycle.
You have a few
Yeah. Okay. So if we play this video again, the whole simulating the whole cycle starts exactly as we start over here. We simulate the intake, the exhaust, the compression, I'm sorry. We simulate combustion when the spark plug discharges. Then we simulate the exhaust stroke. And that's actually, this whole thing lasts one day. But the problem in this case, the computationally expensive part, is to simulate the exhaust, because we have very high gradients of velocity when the exhaust valve opens and we have a very narrow gap over there. So we have to get to very high levels of AMR. So we have a very, very refined grid over there. The user specifies the parameters, so I specify the parameters. Velocity gradient is one of them. Species gradient, some species of interest, like the radicals I showed before, or methane, which is our fuel. Temperature also. Some people use pressure. In this case, it's not very relevant, but some other people use pressure as well. So you can define whichever property you want.
So for the K, here you use K omega, the epsilon model, right?
Yeah. In our future simulations, we are already starting setting up a model that's going to be using different. You mean the turbulence model, right? Yeah, we're trying to set up different models, but RNGK epsilon actually works well in this case. So for more complicated cases, we might need to go, instead of Reynolds average Navier-Stokes, to large eddy simulations. Hopefully not DNS, because it's going to be very expensive, but we will probably try different methods.
How about the cost of this species? You said that you have 53 species in this case.
Yeah, and 325 reactions, yeah.
Comparing to the close over, this couple momentum, what is the ratio?
Actually, the way combustion is done over here is that depending on the lambda and the temperature, the computational domain is split into groups, into regions. And each one of those regions is solved numerically only once, and then it's recoupled to the computational fluid dynamics. So there is this is a multi-zone, an adaptive multi-zone model, so we don't have direct simulation of combustion, but this model has shown to work very well with spark ignition combustion, and it's pretty trustworthy, and the computational cost we save is significant. So let's go with Dan.
I was just wondering how accurate the prediction of the exhaust products actually is. Because you didn't really show any comparison with the experiment.
Yes. In this case, the experiments are gonna come quite later. We started with modeling. As I showed you, in this case, it's first of all, it's plausible because the results coincide with literature. But everything in internal combustion engines comes down to the actual engine. So as long as we have the engine and the test cell to test it, we're going to be able to say more about the accuracy. But in this case, the results agree with literature, which is important for the start of the model. Amir.
Is your piston free or?
No. This piston is a. It's exactly as you can see over here. It's controlled by a crank slider mechanism. It's like the piston you have in your engine. What do you mean?
You mean you put everything in the conveyor?
What do you mean?
You put the actual piston with the red there, or no? You just put some flat surface and apply resistance force on it.
Okay, so in this case, this simulation I showed you, this is a simulation with prescribed wall boundary condition, and what I did was the piston was just a plate. It's not a flat plate, but it's a plate.
Excuse me, can you go back to the slide that you had, the image of your model?
Yeah.
We'll help you explain how it works.
Okay. So, in this case, as you can see, the piston is a plate with no thickness, in this case, though. If we did some simulations for something called conjugate heat transfer, and I have it.
Okay, so here you put a resistive force on a piston.
No, you just specify the motion of the piston, either through a motion file, so saying that this is the velocity as a function of time, or the position as a function of time, or you can specify the mechanism, and it's actually an equation called the crank slider mechanism, which depends on the, depending on the speed of the piston, the piston speed, the actual speed of your engine, the, you can predict the position of the piston in every time step. It's similar, you can do either.
So, you're having some simulation, and then one phase is being completed first, and then you're applying the second phase, or no? There's some kind of parallel?
Depends. We can do either. What we try to do, in order to have parametrical analysis, we simulated the intake and the compression, and then because our interest is in combustion, we started simulating different different spark timings, so different time when the spark discharges, or different energy from the spark, or different turbulence models, based on the compression, on the intake and compression event that was fixed, so that we can save time. But we can do the whole engine simulation. We can do anything, but it's computationally less expensive to do it in parts. Yeah, you're right. That's actually a good question, and it has a little bit to do with what many people asked before. Initially, you go with literature, and these initial conditions might be a little bit arbitrary. That's why, to initialize our model, we had a couple of full runs, so that we had a prediction of the temperature in the cylinder when we started, a prediction of the intake temperature, of the prediction of the residual gases, of the exhaust gases that were remaining in the cylinder. And based on that, we mapped our following runs so that we have a more realistic model.
Yep. Is there a specific reason you are using Converge?
Yes, I think, I don't know if I mentioned that, but I was supposed to anyways. Converge is the industry standard for internal combustion engine applications. And it's been used by industries, by universities in the recent years since it was developed. And another reason is that their support. Their support is very active and very good.
To build the actual mess, the computational mess. This thing does it automatically. And this helps a lot our work because we like developing computational tools, but we can only do it up to a certain level. After that, we lose focus. Our focus is to use the tools to do engine research. So for us, this is perfect. It's a CFD tool for non-CFD experts initially to start with. Later on, as we gain more understanding, more in-depth understanding of the models, we can tweak them and we can create user-defined functions if you want to do something, very low level that this cannot do. So we can interfere with that later on.
How much time is spent on the mesh generation?
Excuse me?
How much time is of the overall computation time is spent on mesh generation?
Depends on, that's really dependent on how much of a fixed, how complicated your mesh is. So if you have very high levels of AMR, you spend more time. So the AMR takes a lot of time because you need first to calculate the gradients, then activate the mesh, and then.
But you guys don't have to do, all your elements are basically just axis aligned squares that may meet up. There may be some non-conforming elements that meet up. But you're not doing any sort of unstructured quad meshing or anything.
No. That's about it, but the thing is that the second mesh you mentioned, the much more refined mesh, it changes, again, not dynamically, but it can change according to the specifications of the user with time, and with space. So you can reduce or increase it for certain durations during your simulation. So it also changes. It's not fixed all over your simulation.
So like to set up these simulations, I mean, it's a week. It's almost just like 7 days or like 32 cores of computer time. But like, just to get an estimate, like how much human time does it take to like set all this up?
To be honest with you, there is not an answer to that because this model is constantly debugged. So you can, you know, start with something simpler and then keep adding and adding and adding. So I think that good estimation would be like 2 to 3 months to become familiar with the tool and make your geometry runnable, as we say, and then start being familiar with all the equations and how they are modeled and, you know, deal with all the minor problems that might be related to initializing. In the recent case, it took me, give or take, 1.5 weeks.
Okay.
Okay.
So, Scott, if you understand, let me test you once again. If I understand your question correctly, you're asking for an engine, how much time does it take to set up a model like this?
That's a good question.
All right, so this is how we do it. If you have an engine, you can have any engine, something that sits in a basement. Typically, what we do is we do 3D scanning of the engine. So we open it up and we scan what you see in the picture. So we scan the valves, the cylinder, and the piston, all that. And so we take that back to CAD, we refine it a little bit, and then we output an STL from CAD, and then Emilio takes that STL and uses it in the GUI of Converge. So he prepares the model that you see right here. So he prepares the boundaries, the surfaces, you know, all the submodels, he prepares it. And once that thing is done in the GUI, then he calls the solver, and the solver takes that that geometry and you know, starts solving all the equations. So, you know, for a model that, for an engine that you don't have the geometry, the CAD, it may take months, you know, to either scan it or create the geometry yourself. If you have the geometry, it's a matter of a week or two just to prepare a running model. Yeah, it's not that bad.
It also depends on the complexity of the model. So you can have very complex models that debugging them and, you know, setting all the submodels might take a while.
So, I mean, how do you handle that piecing little models together? Like, you've got this valve and cylinder, maybe your initial scan, you end up with a leaky valve.
Yes. So some of the work is done by the person who is responsible of CADing. So when we get the 3D scan, somebody processes it in SolidWorks or something relevant, and we get the STL file from there. So some of the work is done over there, and some of the work is done into the graphical user interface of Converge. For example, in the valve, we move the valve close enough to the valve seats, and the valve seats are those small boundaries you can see over here, and they're especially important for sealing the valves. And when the valve lift, which is the distance between the seat and the valve is smaller than a specified amount, the Converge closes the valve. So it regards that there is no flow between the valve and the cylinder. And that's exactly what's going on with the piston over here, because the piston doesn't fit exactly into the liner. Again, we create some sort of a fictitious seal, so that we don't have leakages.
Do you guys care about any sort of fluid structure interaction?
We don't yet, but we will in the future. It's one of the next steps in the model.
So you said you do the piston movement by described file. So and related to this question, and then how do you know that, for example, if your combustion for my if it is more powerful, then it moves your piston faster.
That's true.
If it's powerful, then
when we have this case, which is a crankshaft-driven engine, it doesn't matter how powerful is your combustion. The piston movement is going to be specific because the force from the camshaft is much higher than the combustion forces. When we have a free piston engine, like the project we're currently starting with my advisor, this is something actually that we have to model either through computational fluid dynamics or through simpler models, system-level models. What is syngas? Syngas, yeah, I explained it briefly. Syngas is a mixture of hydrogen and CO and carbon monoxide. So it's a product of biogas, of biomass aposynthesis. So the... we're trying to increase... because there is literature showing that increasing the hydrogen content in spark ignition engines can have benefits and can extend the lean limit, which means that we can go in higher efficiencies and lower NOx emissions at the same time. So that's the idea behind that. Good. Okay. So I believe that's it. Thank you very much.
Okay, let's take our figure once again.
Thank you. Thank you.